Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for making the time and being here. As you know, last month we had a Cap Dev Week at ILRI, and I gave this talk, or a very similar one, in Nairobi, but unfortunately we had some technical difficulties, so the audio wasn't coming through or the WebEx here. So I figured the first chance I'll get to come to Addis, I'll give the talk again in person here, and hopefully you can hear me okay, so we don't have any WebEx difficulties here. I'll speak for all about 30 minutes or so and try to give you a broad overview of capacity development across the Institute. It won't cover everything, because for that we'll need far more than 30 minutes. So feel free to stop me at any point during the presentation, but certainly I'll be very happy to engage on anything that might not be covered here or that you'd like to dig in a little bit deeper after the presentation as well. So, I won't read everything that's on the slide in front of you, but as you can see, we have quite a lot to share and quite a lot to cover because there really is quite a lot going on. So this is the 30-minute speed dating version of CalDev at ILRI. To start off with, I'd like to just recap a little bit where CalDev comes from in terms of where it sits in the ILRI strategy and fits in with ILRI's vision and mission. So, as you all know, ILRI has three strategic objectives. One of them is to grow capacity, and five critical success factors, one of which is, again, to grow the capacity. And therefore, that really gives us the anchor and the guidance of where we need to focus our efforts in the quest to help us all achieve the overall ILRI vision and mission. Now, within the broader CGIAR context, there's been a lot going on in the last few years on capacity development. This is actually quite an exciting time to be in capacity development or to be aware of capacity development, whatever your function is. One of the reasons is that there's a very strong renewed interest and focus on capacity development. We see that, for instance, with the SRF, the Strategy and Results Framework, the so-called Bible of the CGIAR, and the June 2015 version has a very strong focus on capacity development compared to the previous version. There is a dedicated section on it, there are very clear indications of how it should be incorporated, and also, and perhaps mostly, there are the so-called IDOs, the Intermediary Development Outcomes. There is an IDO on capacity development with four distinct sub-IDOs, and that will help guide the work of CRPs throughout the second phase of 2017-2022. So there will be a lot going on there. There is a lot of work that was done by the Capacity Development Community of Practice, which is a CGIAR-Y group, to help CRTs and centers be more ready for this. One of the things that was prepared is a capacity development framework for the second round of CRPs, which has been adopted after a long round of consultations and sets out the framework with 9 distinct elements plus capacity to innovate. More recently, in November of last year, a document was released around capacity development indicators. That is still a first draft, there will still be more consultations and work in progress, but that is really a key issue as well, because whatever we don't count doesn't count. And if we don't have good indicators, then it'll just stay, you know, as an abstract notion that we pay lip service to. So we really want to make it something actionable, and therefore we'll see a lot more on that going forward. Perhaps the most attention-grabbing, though, was the decision to put some more resources behind an enhanced community of practice, and right now, as it looks, there'll be a minimal support of around $1 million a year, and then perhaps more, and in future, to grow that into a fully-fledged platform on capacity development. So there's a lot going on there. And ILRI has been playing a very active role. We were involved from the start in reviving the community of practice, and we play an active role in it. And so there's a lot of opportunities there, and also a lot of recognition for our work there. So this seems a bit of retrofitting, saying that Cap Dev Week was a month ago, almost to the day. But still, the why behind it is still important, now and into the future. So why do we have a Cap Dev Week? What's so new and exciting? Well, first of all, what you should walk away with is that everyone should walk away from this room exactly like that logo. You know, feeling really excited about capacity development and ability. Because there really is a lot going on. If you've been paying attention, a lot of it isn't that new. It's things that have been going on throughout in terms of our approaches, how we embed it, how we use best practice in a range of fields to take it forward. But we did spruce up a number of things for Cap Dev Week. So for example, the Cap Dev section of the website, which I'm sure you will visit every morning before you do anything else, got a makeover. You also had a first wave of online courses, and I'll speak more about that later, going live in Cap Dev Week. We had a series of Cap Dev briefs launched, so 8 went live. There are copies here in the room that you can pick up to supplement the ones that you already have in your room and in your office. And we have a long pipeline of many more. So I mean, this Cap Dev Week could easily have been a Cap Dev Month, because there really is a lot going on. And there were a range of presentations, you know, some of which by people sitting in the room. So Musha had a presentation, Deborah had a presentation, and so on. So 8 presentations throughout the week, all of which were recorded, with the exception of mine, which had technical difficulties and being re-recorded now. So all of them will be also available online for you to revisit and to dig deeper into. One of the other reasons we had Cap Dev Week is because for some people there was still the misconception that capacity development is only about the administration of fellowship contracts. So we needed to really give a little bit of a broader perspective. With that said, the first thing I'll talk to you about is a little bit of fellowship numbers. But I'll do that relatively quickly. It's still an important part of ILRI's mandate in capacity development. And so even though I'll talk maybe slightly more passionately about some of the newer innovative stuff that we're doing, this remains a very important part and will continue to be so. So the numbers that you have here are actually newly recruited in 2015. It gives you an overview, so about 206 graduate fellows, research fellows, and interns, and it gives you the breakdown by programs so that you can see which programs are sort of driving it. You can see that ASSP tops the list, and that's single-handedly thanks to the LIFES program that represents that on its own would also be up there. But there are many other programs with good work in this area. We also have good balance, so 28 nationalities, around 40% female. So we're doing good work in this area, and we hope to continue on this trend. We also have a new fellowship information system going live soon. We've been piloting it for the last few months in Nairobi, and we'll take it live in the next quarter or two once it's fully integrated into all of ILRI's ICT systems and so on. It's a fully compatible with OCS system, so we recognized early on that this might not be the first priority of OCS when going live, but we needed a system that would allow us to be more efficient, to have better reporting, to avoid multiple spreadsheets and so on, and try to eliminate the sort of long email and paper trails that were associated with administration. We're very happy about that. It took about 2 years to put together, and we're very excited to have that go live throughout, both here in Addis, in Nairobi, and throughout the region. So look out for more information on that in the coming months. We also have a lot of short-term trainings taking place at ILRI, and that will also continue to be an important part of individual training. So as you see again, ASSP is doing fantastic with over 6,000 trained in 2015. And ILRI as a whole had over 140 trainings throughout, reaching over 8,500 people. So a lot going on there. We will want to get this information refined a bit more. So trying to get into the categories of people trained, trying to track that a little bit better, also trying to align that with dashboards to the board so that we can get that information a little bit more clearly. And also, we'd really like to follow up on the impact of that. So whether we've trained 5 people, 50, or 5,000, what has been the impact of those? And that's going to require us to go back and refine that a little bit better. But we have a very good base. And this, again, cuts across the institute, maybe not evenly, but everyone recognizes that this is something that forms part of their work. Now, it's very important to stress that capacity development at ILRI is far bigger than the captive unit. And that's the way it should be. So if we track, for instance, full-term FTEs, full-time equivalents, across the institutes, so we see that, for instance, the captive unit isn't the first or the second unit in terms of staffing. And that's the way we want it. We want it embedded in the programs, in the units, and even those 7 positions that you see on the captive unit, 75% of those are paid directly by programs, so are doing programmatic work. So we're very happy to see that. There's around 40 full-time equivalent positions at ILRI, and more than 100 individuals who are involved in delivering those. And they're spread throughout the institute, most in the integrated sciences, but also in the biosciences and also in institutional planning and partnerships. What that means is that not only there's lots that's going on, but also there's a lot of opportunities for better synergies and for making the whole bigger than the sum of its parts. Because really, it's across the institute. It's not the captive unit that does have the evidence. The next thing I want to touch on quickly is some of the work that we've been doing, and really you can say pioneering in the case of ILRI and the CG, instructional design and applying all kinds of learning, including online and blended learning. So instructional design, as I'm sure everyone who attended Deborah's presentation can tell us, is basically a form of applied educational psychology that we use in order to make learning more effective. Accessible, effective. Instructional designers would probably not be able to do very much on their own. So that's why it's always a combination of having an instructional designer working together with the subject matter experts to take the materials to the next level and really make them effective. And we're getting a lot of traction on that. It was very hard to get people to buy into this concept initially. But now it's growing more and more, and we're very happy about that. So Deborah here is a full-time instructional design specialist based here in Addis, and she is the only full-time instructional designer in the whole of the CJR system. Yeah? So again, this is something where ILRI is taking the lead on. We have a range of a roster of consultants and advisors that we also work with so that we can respond to growing needs. And this is indeed a growing area where we have more work coming up, and we're very excited about that. So a couple of examples. So one example is the FEAST materials. How many in the room know the FEAST materials? Okay. So the FEAST stands for the Feed Assessment Tool. It's basically, in a nutshell, a participatory and rapid method of assessing feed strategies. And it's been used for many years and in many countries before we got involved. And what we were asked to do together with the FEAST experts, so Michael is sitting here in the room, and Alan Duncan, and then Lukuyu and others, is basically work on the delivery. But in so doing, we had a lot of revisions of the process. The tools themselves also got tweaked in the process and refined further. But the big thing was, you know, a new interactive course. So the course itself, which was actually launched here in Addis in May of 2015, in conjunction with the e-learning Africa conference, which took place in Addis last year, where it was also presented, ended up looking like a modular, a 12 modular set of lessons, over 60 videos, so over 3 hours of videos, 5 interactive scenario-based exercises, and lots of over 200 exercise and review questions to help reinforce learning and to help people gauge how they're doing. It's a blended experience, and by blended we mean that we take an online component and a face-to-face traditional component, and we use them together. And that's worked out quite well. In the picture you see Ben Nokuyu using some of the online materials in a face-to-face training in, this is in Uganda, in November of 2014. So there's a lot going on there, and that is related to a new learning management system that we have. Who here is familiar with the term learning management system, or LMS? So, a learning management system is basically a platform where we can play these learning materials. Now, you could say that we could just, you know, load all the videos to YouTube and send a YouTube link and just have all the rest of the stuff there and let people just play around with it. And that's one option of doing it, but generally speaking, not a very good one. So what we want to have is an ability to track performance, to see how people are doing, to integrate a lot of different components. And that's done using specialized software and using specialized formats of the industry. Typically, these would be a SCORM compliant or TinCan and so on. What we want to be doing is creating something that we can use and host that really gives a very nice user-friendly experience to the users, while giving a lot of functionality in the back end in terms of our tracking and reporting and management abilities. We thought that we'd find this off the shelf. It turned out that it's not that simple to find what we want for a number of reasons. One, it's an extremely fragmented market. There are literally thousands and thousands of web vendors. There isn't sort of a one vendor that captures the market and so on. The second thing is that the countries and the audiences that we're trying to reach are fundamentally different than what the industry is gearing itself to. So, by and large, the industry has been Googleized. So they all expect us to be running on US-based servers and have 24/7 access to broadband and all run on, you know, latest equipment and so on. So when we think of the context of Ethiopia or many of the countries that ILRI works in, that's simply a pipe dream. We needed a system that would work also in low bandwidth environments. We needed a system that would not rely on all kinds of existing infrastructure environments. At the end, we partnered with Sonaka Learning, who were very accommodating incorporating all of our wish list into their development plan, and today we have something that's very exciting, that's a clean interface, that understands that we want to blend things, that works in low bandwidth environments, that has good reporting features, and in the URL there, a few courses are live. We'd love for you to go around and play with it and experience it further. But perhaps as or more exciting is the so-called offline player. Because even if we have connectivity, and sometimes great connectivity, here on the Addis campus, when we go out to the field, we won't have that anymore. And that's as valid in Ethiopia as it's valid in perhaps 80% of the countries that ILRI works in. So we didn't want something that would look great at, you know, the head office, but then when you actually went to implement with it, it became useless. So we wanted to create the same rich online learning experience offline. Ironically, the industry was closer to offering that 20 years ago than it is today. Today people just assumed, you know, everyone is always online. So all of the systems that we had back, you know, CD-ROM based trainings and all of that, have all been left behind. So today the only ones, you know, we scattered for existing solutions, the only ones who had anything, you know, remotely functional were, you know, militaries. And they weren't too keen on, you know, sharing it with an organization that wanted to make it open source and accessible to everyone. So we ended up having Sonata develop an offline player that essentially enables us to deliver the full content offline as well. It also has some practical features built into it. So if you take the USB stick and you copy it to another computer, as people will do, that's perfectly fine, it gives them a unique identifier. So we can still track individual performance. So long as at one point someone can take that information, go to a place with infinite connectivity and send it back, we can also integrate it to our main online platform for reporting and tracking. So that's something that we're very happy with. And incidentally, we've negotiated with our partner, with Sonata Learning, that this is accessible with no extra cost to any CGIAR center, sort of piggybacking on ILRI's license. So if there are other colleagues from other centers who think they'd like to use that, you're absolutely welcome to do that with no additional cost. This somewhat digital environment leads me to the next segment, which is ICT for Ag, or how technology can play a role in the agricultural solutions that we hope to achieve. And firmly believe that ICT is part of the solution, ICT for Ag. And there's a lot going on in ILRI. I have a few projects listed on the screen, but they're really just scratching the surface, and that's just from the stuff that I happen to know about, because there are probably a dozen other projects that I know nothing about. It's highly fragmented still, and that's probably something that we as ILRI would want to consolidate better, because it's a huge part of the future with the way technology is advancing. In the United States, they have this day that they call Black Flag Friday. Black Friday is essentially a retail holiday. Everyone goes shopping, there are great discounts, and it's a whole shopping phenomenon. In Black Friday last November, so a couple of months ago, you could have bought a pretty decent smartphone, a Motorola E. So a 4.5-inch screen, you know, 8 GB of RAM, you know, good processor, running the latest Android operating system for $10. I'm not missing a zero. $10. When we start getting state-of-the-art hardware for $5, for $10, for $15, and we combine that with free or cheap basic internet connectivity, a lot of the things that still today look like a pipe dream in terms of what we can do in terms of accessibility, tracking, data, all the rest of it, will be huge game changers. So it may seem like a pipe dream, but we're really close. Maybe 5 years away, certainly 10 years away. But then again, people were saying that 5 and 10 years ago, so you know, don't hold me to that. But I really think there's a huge potential. Some of the projects that are already starting to experiment with it are showing pretty cool stuff. So for instance, the Iddo Dror project is using gamified m-learning, mobile learning, to increase organizational efficiency with the insurance partners they're working with. You know, pretty fun stuff, pretty cutting-edge stuff, but also a lot of useful insights coming out of it. In the animal health side, we have rapid diagnostics on a chip, you know, which can be powered by a mobile phone and use that same mobile phone to send back the results and get information. Again, cutting a process by time, efficiency, cost, you know, real big game changers. We have projects looking at nutrition and various angles, and nutrition and pigs. There are systems that are looking into how to better track information to help transform genetics, and so on and so forth. So there's a lot going on here, and this is really something that we're excited to be a part of. To give one specific example, the M-Nutrition project. So it's a project where ILRI is part of a consortium led by CABI in partnership with GAIN, Oxfam, and the British Medical Journal. This is a consortium looking to improve the lives of over a million mothers in 10 countries in sub-Saharan Africa and actually 4 more in South Asia, so 14 countries in total, using the mobile channel as its primary conduit. The work ILRI is doing revolves around leading the training components, quality assurance, business support to mobile providers, and so on. And we're very happy about that and excited about some of the things in the learnings that are coming, because a lot of it is really generic. So for instance, if we developed, as we did, courses on how to create content for the mobile channel, that's something that can be used by any project that has an M, a small M before the rest of the acronym in front of it. So we're really hoping that these sort of projects will pave the way to a lot of exciting stuff in the coming years. One thing that we do, probably the best kept secret at ILRI, there is actually research on capacity development. It's not only a service function. Not as much as I'd like to see, but a lot of potential there. So one example is the one that I mentioned before, the Iddo Dror learning gamification. That's an experimental design, so a randomized controlled trial, and so on, looking at the effects of traditional training versus M-learning versus cash incentives, and so on. Really interesting insights came out of wave one. They're now informing the design of wave two. And this is cutting-edge stuff, you know. There aren't too many places where you can go and read about RCTs being done on the mobile channel with gamification, let alone in places like, you know, pastoralist areas in Ethiopia and Kenya. So a lot of interesting stuff there, and there's a lot of potential to do so much more. Another area, which is a sort of blended area, it has the service components, it has the research components, is the whole work on innovation systems, innovation platforms. A lot done here in the Ethiopia campus over the years, continues to do so. So some examples from this past year. So there's been a recent publication on mature innovation platforms, a landscape through 3 continents, through a crowdfunded case study competition, which was published just around Christmas. But also that lends itself to an online blended course, which Deborah is leading. And I'll talk about it in a second. So there's this really sort of both ways that you can look at these things, and we'd really like to encourage those of you who are involved to really look at some of the research aspects as well. It's very interesting. And this is not going away. So the sub-IDOs that I mentioned just before, so the sub-IDO on capacity development has 4 sub-IDOs, 2 of which are on capacity to innovate, which is the core of this stuff. So it's here to stay at least for a while. This online blended course, don't worry, I'm not going to read everything on that dense slide, but it really is exciting, and it has a lot of potential to become the reference material for training on innovation systems within the CG system, and hopefully before. So half of it is live already, so you can visit the e-learning platform, learning.ilri.org, and experience it, and the other half will come live this year. Finally, opportunities. So there are a lot of opportunities. My first question will be, how many people in this room are aware of everything that I've shared today? And that's what I get wherever I share this with people. So getting that information out is very useful, because there's a lot of synergies to be had here. And that's really what we want to encourage. The power of this is, once it's embedded in a program, it's once all scientists can take and leverage this work and really take it forward, it will never be done by a small capacity development unit on its own, nor do we want it to be. We really want to embed these principles and best practices and learn from a lot of good corners in the Institute and help get it to others. And finally, now a very concrete opportunity. We are in the design stage of the series that we capture things properly so that we don't have to retrofit them later. 30 minutes to the dot. I think I'll stop here. Thank you very much for being patient and for your attention so far.